Welcome to the Executive Insights Podcast brought to you by AWS. My name is Becky Weiss. I'm a Vice President and Distinguished Engineer at AWS, and I am thrilled to be here talking today to Tony Chor. Tony is a VP at Amazon, and he runs our Builderworks organization. So, Tony, can you tell us a little bit about what that is?
Yeah, sure thing. Thanks for having me.
Of course.
I lead a development team that designs, builds, and operates the systems that Amazon, other Amazon builders use to create the shopping experiences that hopefully most of you, our listeners, are familiar with. This is everything from our homepage and our mobile shopping applications, all the way through to managed compute, data, networking systems, all built on top of AWS, of course. And I've been doing this, I think, about 11 years now.
Fantastic. Thank you so much for joining us. So what we're here to talk about today, our topic for today is developer use of generative AI in organizations. This is a very hot topic out in the world because it has a lot of, you know, it has a lot of technical and non-technical aspects, right? There's an incredible potential for improved productivity, incredible potential for improved quality. And at the same time, it is definitely a shift in how we engineers do our jobs. And there's a little bit of both excitement and anxiety surrounding that change. And so we're going to talk a little bit about kind of how you are managing that change in your organization, how you address developers' concerns, and you know what your developers are already getting out of it. You run a very large development organization. Tell us a little bit about some wins, some success stories of use of generative AI by developers.
Sure. I mean, you know, we're really a traditional back-end Java services team primarily, not a science team. And so, you know, we've been, I think like a lot of teams, a lot of companies, just on this learning journey through the new tools and the changes that are there. And so we're taking some of the tools from AWS first Code Whisperer and now Q-Code Dev and working with that. And some teams have found it really helpful for them. And in other cases, you know, we've had to wait for a few months and to get a new update to see the improvements. And we've also learned that we have to train our developers to use new tools too. They don't just work out of the box necessarily. They, you know, have to shift their mindset. But in other places, we've started using Gen AI to answer questions for our internal support. We're now just now getting to the point where the accuracy is good enough, and the teams are finding it super helpful for that. And as we're sort of bootstrapping ourselves up into this now, the teams and using the tools more and the technologies that are available, the teams are starting to think about the problems differently, which is really exciting to see. And so they're starting to become non-obvious uses for the tools. It turns out the LLMs really can understand code pretty well and then translate that into useful insights. So maybe a small thing we've done that's been really paying off now is in our build pipelines, we automatically generate the release notes after every build. No developer likes to write release notes. They often don't do a good job of it. But the LLM goes through, looks at all the changes, and summarizes for them. The developer okays it, and we publish that out. And so the quality of our documentation has gotten a bunch better. And actually, we're seeing a lot of maybe the most wins on this sort of outer loop stuff, not the inner loop of coding. And
yeah, because actually the fact is we spend a very small percentage of our time on this. Right,
right. It's the answering questions, summarizing, writing documentation,
yeah.
Things like that, which the developers aren't great at, don't all love doing, and it's really where we spend a lot of the time. And that's, to me, been kind of the biggest surprise is where we're seeing those wins.
Yeah, I mean, Tony, this is something that I've experienced myself, is that one of the greatest quality opportunities for use of generative AI is in all of those, you call them outer loop, all of those outer loop tasks that most developers actually don't want to do. It's not what they were excited about doing. And more so when they're crunched for time,
exactly.
They got a boss breathing down their neck, the things, you know, deadlines next week. It's going to be the first thing that they start to skimp on. And these are tasks where I think we're already seeing that that Q developer has a real sweet spot. And you talk about release notes. You know that actually most of the toil there actually isn't even the unit testing. It's building all of the scaffolding to create the conditions that you need to test. That stuff isn't rocket science, but it requires activation energy, time spent debugging this silly, and it really does shorten shorten that time so that I have more time to do the parts that I actually was interested in, that I actually wanted to do. As you talk to your engineers, though, my guess is you probably hear a mixed bag of reactions to this change.
Yeah, for sure. Absolutely. You know, I think like any new thing, there's some population that's really eager to embrace it and curious. There's a whole bunch of sort of undecided. And then there's a bunch of sort of skeptics, frankly, all the way to people who are afraid of change. I mean, there's no change without loss perceived loss. Anyway, maybe one of the biggest surprises for us as we started embarking on this journey is that the group that is embracing the change the most and is really driving and leading a lot of our efforts are some of our more junior engineers, ones right out of college that don't have set ways of working or maybe have been exposed to some of these technologies in college and stuff. And they're the ones teaching our principal engineers. Gee, as you know, for most of our kind of traditional systems, that's not the case, right? Normally, it's often our sort of senior leaders kind of guiding and setting direction and stuff. And here, it's much more of everybody's learning together, and sometimes it's the junior engineers who are really teaching the most. And what we're seeing now is as we get past the initial wave of the hype cycle, people are seeing the reality of what the tools can do. That sort of skeptical group is starting to be won over.
Right.
Now they're seeing, wow, this really can do something useful here. It is maybe not what the hype said, but it's super valuable, super useful, in a really radically different way of working and thinking. So people who've been working in the same space for 10 years or something are now suddenly like showing up to work with kind of a bounce in their step, and they're really excited to try these new approaches.
There's a lot of hype around Gen AI, and particularly Gen AI writing code. If you read the hype, you might go into it expecting, well, wow, this is going to do everything, right? This is going to make me breakfast,
right?
And if you go in with that expectation, you will find that it did not make you breakfast, right? And if you go in with those expectations, you'll be disappointed. And then the question is, what do you do from there, right? If you're an experienced technologist, you know that the thing I tried wasn't the sweet spot. I need to actually look for where this match and where this fit is. You need to keep sort of probing for that. I can also imagine a reaction like, no breakfast. So that's one way of looking at this. The other way is sort of what you talked about with the junior engineers, and I'm going to go even farther than that. I've talked to customers who have put forth a hypothesis that I think may well be correct, that the next wave of what we think of as technological innovations may not actually come from the people we think of as technologists anymore.
I think that's right.
And so it's a very different audience who's going to be consuming this, who's going to be making things with this. And I'm very, very eager to see what that looks like. Because I myself am an experienced technologist. And so like I know how my side of the world works. And, you know, of course, like how we deal with expectations of a new technology and then dashed expectations and then figuring out the sweet spot. I'm very curious to see how this other side is going to play out.
Yeah, I think that's right. I mean, the history of our industry really is democratizing what was constrained to a set of experts and allowing a lot more people to be able to take advantage. Word processing even is a good example of that. But digital photography, digital music have really opened up the audience that can express themselves and can build things now. And I absolutely believe that Gen AI will do that more outside of the traditional realm of what we would consider as developers or builders today.
Yeah. Now, of course, there's a little bit of an elephant in the room on that one, right? The duel of lots of people can do my job now is a fear of job displacement. Have you heard that from your staff?
Yeah, of course. And I think, you know, again, we've been through many waves like this together, and there's always that kind of concern. I think some of it's real. Like
yeah.
The if you define your job as the things you do today, then I think there will be some displacement. But if you think of your job as problem solving and building and stuff, the content of your work will a lot of people's work will change. Our work, mm-hmm. The content of our work will change.
For sure.
But the roles will still be there. There'll still be a need for people who can think, dream, invent, and listen to customers and address those concerns to operate big systems and things. And we'll just do it differently.
Yeah, I do actually think that there's a possible very good outcome from all of this, which is that the human side of what we bring to work is actually going to be maximized. I'll give you an example. It's actually not about code. It's about another use of Gen AI that I'm very enthusiastic about, which is summarizing.
Yes.
So Amazon is famous for its document culture, right? We communicate with each other in documents. Of course, that means a lot of reading if you're on the receiving end of that. And, you know, as a senior engineer in the organization who interfaces with a lot of different parts of AWS and deals with a fairly large cast of characters in any given day, I often get, you know, a Slack message from someone that says, "Hey, Becky, you might find this interesting. Document link."
Right.
Right. What do you do with that? Before I had these tools at my disposal, I had to just triage aggressively based on criteria that may have been good and may not have been good, right? Do I know this person? What do I think they work on? What do I think this document's going to say, right? And I would choose whether to go look at it or not. And I know because I now get the chance to summarize these documents quickly makes me a much more responsive colleague. I can respond to them in 30 seconds, whereas before I would need to have even decided that I'm going to open the link and take a look.
And I think on that same summary note, one of the things I've loved the most now, and you're familiar with this too, is in our ticketing system, as a leader of these systems, I'm jumping in and out all day, and it was always hard to know, like, what's the current status of the event and stuff. And now I can look at this great summary. Frank, it's better than the human-generated ones in most cases.
Oh, for sure.
And I can start doing the human part of it, like you said, thinking, analyzing, you know, prioritizing instead of having to spend my time pouring through the ticket and trying to figure out what the status is and stuff. And it's been a real dream, frankly.
Yeah, I can relate to that as well. At AWS, our developers are, for the most part, extremely hands-on operationally involved in the availability of and resilience of our services. One of my jobs at AWS is a call leader, which means that when we have, you know, in the rare event, we have an operational issue, you know, of course, we do what you think. You have a conference call, lots of people in a, you know, professionally moderated and led. And you get paged into one of these calls, the ticket's on fire. People are saying all kinds of stuff. And they've been saying all kinds of stuff for a while. And the stuff towards the bottom of the ticket is actually not that accurate anymore. That's what they think was happening until they learn more. And these summaries are so good because before that, I was like trying to read the ticket and assess which parts of it are useful and not useful all the while people are talking to me. And I'm,
that's right.
Right. And it's just, it allows me to apply the human part of this call leader role because I'm no longer just spending my time buried in a ticket trying to understand it.
Yeah, that's right.
And all of this is outer loop stuff. All of this is outer loop stuff, right? You're looking at code that somebody wrote 5 years, 10 years ago. And, you know, I'm an experienced engineer. I know I have methods for tracing it through, walking it through. I know how to read code. It is much nicer to be able to ask something like, you know, break this down for me. What does this do? How is it structured, right?
Yeah, that's right.
And it doesn't actually atrophy my skills in any way. It just shortens the part that I was sort of doing mechanically before.
Yeah, that makes a ton of sense. And so how do you think then, for you and for the developers and maybe more junior developers you're working with, how is this going to change career growth and the kinds of things people will have to learn? Like, what will be different?
Well, I don't actually think this is a new thing in our industry. The technology itself is certainly new, but technological shifts are not that new. 10 years ago, early in my career at AWS, I used to work on virtual private cloud. This is the network capabilities of EC2, meaning customers have control over many aspects of their network, network security, network logging, all these things. And this was much earlier in cloud adoption, you know, back in like 2013, 14. Certainly customers you've heard of were adopting the cloud, but a lot hadn't set foot in the cloud yet. So you were talking to a lot of customers at the beginning of their cloud migration journey. And one of the characters you would talk to are the folks who would manage the data center network for the customers before they come into AWS. So you're talking to them about virtual private cloud and about what they can do with this. You know, they get this unprecedented visibility and control, and it's all API driven, meaning that the job that they were doing in the data center, they now gets turbocharged and also both, we think, easier, but also different. Right. And so you're talking to these folks. They bring a lot of expertise. Right. Like they really do understand, you know, they really do understand the networking needs of a workload that, you know, that you might run in the cloud. But at the same time, you're bringing them a bunch of new techniques that actually means that they're going to shift how they spend their time, right? And, you know, and in those conversations, I could kind of see that there was like, you know, both excitement, like look what we could do with the cloud, right? We couldn't do that on premises, as well as a little bit of anxiety about this. That's the difference, the new skill set. 10 years later, you know, we see that there was a large scale embrace of these new skills, right? A lot of the folks who were previously spending a lot of time on undifferentiated heavy lifting of networking in data centers are now spending time operating a virtual private cloud environment in AWS with a lot more power, right? So this is going to be like that. The mix of tasks in a developer's day will be different 5 years from now than they are today, just like they are different today than they were 10 years
ago.
You're right.
That sounds, I mean, reminds me of when we went from assembly and people were skeptical about compilers, like, oh, I can never trust a compiler to as good a job as I do. And then once we moved from C++ and C to Java managed memory, oh, it can never do as good a job as I do. And it turns out we have more developers than ever. And we still need some people who know how to do those things.
That's
but not
right.
as many. And we're just all way more productive for not chasing NPEs and things anymore. So I think you're right. I think it's going to be just a shift in what we do.
Yeah. Fantastic. So, you know, you have a lot of peers of yours from all around the world kind of watching our conversation today. They're in a similar situation that you are. They have a staff of developers who's both excited and anxious about generative AI and what that means for them. Can you leave them with one or two pieces of advice? How can they navigate this successfully? How can they help their staffs navigate this successfully?
I think the thing that we've found helpful and that actually even our senior leadership have reinforced now with us is get your hands dirty, start using the tools. Don't prematurely optimize and say, oh, this is not a good task for Gen AI or something. Hit everything with a Gen AI stick for a little while. Learn to see what's possible. Embrace it. Some of those aren't going to go to production. That's fine. Teams are learning, changing their thinking models and stuff. And so at this point, I think it's really just start doing it. No one's an expert. Not too many people are experts in this yet and stuff. And so we're all learning together.
Yes.
And just get started.
Yeah. I mean, I would absolutely echo that. I would also say, like, it's good to go in there with sort of a realistic understanding of the nature of new technologies generally, of which this is one. And that means you're going to have to listen a little bit extra hard to understand what's working. Where are we finding the sweet spots? Which are the wins that we want to that we want to double down on? Which are the things where you're hearing that it actually doesn't yet work well, and maybe it's time to pause that and take another look at it, because this is rapidly evolving
that's
technology.
Right. I think that's a really critical point. This is one of the biggest changes now is in the previous waves of technology, if something didn't work, maybe you'd wait 12 months, 18 months, and wait for the next version of something to come out, and then you could try again. Now it's 3 months, 2 months, a few weeks. So it's important not to write things off because they didn't work today.
Yeah.
The change could be right around the corner that makes it workable for you.
Just make sure that folks, you know, that folks have the space to actually kind of learn these are legitimately new skills. They're going to change the mix of how we spend our days, and make sure that they have the space to skill up, for modern development, for what will be modern development skills in the next couple of years.
Absolutely.
Well, Tony, I wanted to thank you so much for spending time with us on the Executive Insights podcast.
Thanks for this opportunity. It's been great being here.
Thank you so much.